We're with Thais Harris, the Nutrition Education Program Manager of the Ceres Project. Which out of all that did I pronounce wrong?
Nothing.
Really?
You got it all right.
I thought I'd mess up manager maybe. I had to look
at
my notes.
Actually, no. I do have to say it's Ceres Community Project.
What is the Ceres Community Project?
We are a nonprofit. We serve organic meals to people that are undergoing a health crisis. 75% of our clients are under $45,000 in income, so we really help a low-income population for the most part.
And part of the philosophy, as I understand, is food is medicine.
Food is medicine.
So you try to provide...
Food is medicine, food as medicine, right?
And food, insert preposition here, medicine, food above, on, over,
yes,
next to.
The idea is that food really is the foundation of health.
Yeah.
And so we work with not only the clients who we serve, but the way we serve them is by using teens in our kitchen. So the teens volunteer their time,
wow,
and they get trained to be chefs, and they get leadership training, and there's a number of other skills that we help them develop while they're working at Ceres.
Like the total virtuous cycle there.
Exactly.
Yeah. Wow.
And give them a real sense of belonging and of contribution in their community. And we also engage many adult volunteers. So there's about 500 teens that we'll have engaged in the year 2015.
That's great.
Yeah.
And by community, and we're talking Santa Rosa, Sonoma, and
Marin. Yeah. So all of Sonoma County. And then in Sonoma County, we have two kitchens, the Sebastopol one and the Sonoma Valley. And then we also have a site in Marin and San Rafael.
So, speaking with you, I hear a very slight accent.
Yes.
You're not from here, are you?
I'm not from here.
That's not the Petaluma Winona Ryder accent. That
it's
is a Brazilian accent.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, I'm from Brazil originally. I moved to the States when I was 19.
What inspired you to leave Brazil? I mean, it's perfect down there.
Oh, right.
That's what that says in the brochure.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
That's for sure. So my grandfather was American, and I always wanted to meet some of my relatives that were here.
This is your grandfather who was 64 with a 24-year-old bride.
Right, exactly. So he was 64, she was 24. She didn't speak English, she didn't speak Portuguese.
What did she speak? It's like, what else do you speak down there?
I'm sorry, did I say the opposite? She didn't speak English, he didn't speak Portuguese.
Okay, yeah.
But they spoke the language of love, of course.
Yeah.
And he was down there drilling for oil, and they met. And anyway, they had six children, one of them being my dad. And he passed long before I was born. But I really wanted to meet the relatives.
Yeah.
I liked speaking English. Both my parents had worked at the American Embassy, and they both spoke English.
Yeah, English is fun. I've gotten really good at it over the years. It's the only one I got, so I gotta perfect it.
Yeah. I was in theater for a while, and I really wanted to lose my accent because I don't really look Brazilian.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to bring it up then.
So I can't.
No, I had notes. I'm cheating. Yeah.
No, but the idea was, I don't look Brazilian, so I can't play roles that are like Brazilian women. And then if I have a Brazilian accent and I don't look Brazilian, people are like, "What is she doing? Is she just weird?" Then yes, but
did you perform? Were you like? Did you act through college or?
I did. Yeah. I did. And
what were your parts?
One of my favorites was Irina in Three Sisters with Porchlight Theater Company.
Right on. Yeah, she's
that
the evil
really
sister.
Fun. No, she's the sweet one.
Ah, okay.
She's the young one.
Yes.
They're all great, but it's Chekhov. Anyway, so.
Like I know.
So fast forward a few years, and I made a pact with one of my cousins that in the year 2000 we were going to go to the U.S. and meet our relatives, and we did. I did an exchange program, and I lived in Florida.
What was that like to be here finally in the U.S.? Was it everything you thought it would be, or?
I was in this very interesting place in Florida in the Gulf Coast.
You're in Cuba.
And it felt very different than life in Brazil, but it was really sweet. It was a little island. Everybody's, driving around in golf carts, and it was great, and it was very relaxing. I worked, but in Brazil, there's so much like fear because you're always like watching your purse, and when you're in certain environments. And there, I remember just like you could leave your doors unlocked and cars.
Yeah, that's not America.
Like
just so you know, that wasn't actually America. You're in Disney World, and
But so that felt different. And when I visited San Francisco for the first time, I really felt like San Francisco was home.
Yeah.
It just felt more, you know, cosmopolitan.
It's an international city.
Yeah, it was amazing. And so I said, I'm going to move here in 2 years. And roughly 11 months later, I was here.
Good for you. That's great.
Wait that long.
What like, in Brazil, like, what were the images of America that you received, like, through the media? Like, how does America represent itself? Or at least, how was it represented in Brazil? And why didn't that turn you off? Or was it good? Or?
Well, you know, it's really... You have movies, mm-hmm. right? So there's this idea. I actually didn't think that cheerleading was really for real because we don't have cheerleading in Brazil, and I thought it was just for the movies. And then when I lived here, I was like, oh no, that's a true thing. So
it's not actually.
Fun.
It is just a thing we do. It's you've fallen for our little trap.
I did. I wanted to be a cheerleader so bad when I was in high school.
Oh my God.
I know, right? My parents had traveled to the U.S. a few times, yeah. and they both loved it. So I had their stories to go by and their friends. And then, you know, there were people that would say that Americans were more closed off and that they weren't as warm as Brazilian people. And, you know, Brazilians are really warm, and everybody that meets you is going to at least give you a hug, if right. not, you know, three kisses on the cheek and things like that. But I always felt that people here were wonderful. I never... Yeah. felt that like coldness. So it's, you know, you hear things and then you see things, and then there were my parents' stories and the movies. And
well, we'll come back and talk about how wonderful we are in America with Thais Harris, the Nutrition Education Program Manager of the Ceres Community Project.
When I was six, I had one thing on my mind. When I was six, my days were spent playing basketball every chance I could. When I was six, my dream was to make it to the NBA. When I was six, my mom had a stroke.
I'm Paul George, and I want you to learn the signs of a stroke fast. FAST.
F, face drooping. A, arm weakness. S, speech difficulty. T, time to call 911. Because the sooner they get to the hospital, the sooner they'll get treatment. And that can make a remarkable difference in their recovery.
Protect the ones you love.
Spot a stroke. FAST. Fast.
In your new role, we help you help. Visit aarp.org/caregiving for information on how to provide even better care for the person who once took care of you.
We're speaking with Thais Harris, the Nutrition Education Program Manager of the Ceres Community Project, and we're just getting into what it means to be in Sonoma County, well, America broadly, but now in Sonoma County, which has become this locale known for its epicuria and its food and the bounty and all the locavore notions that surround that kind of activity. And you guys have leveraged that into a program that directly benefits those in need in the county. What came first? The awareness that it's awesome here and you can grow anything you want, or was the need made explicit first? What happened?
You know, I think it's funny, they go together, right? Yeah. I think the need came first. Catherine Couch, our executive director, she was teaching teenagers to cook. Like, that's how it started. And they thought, well, let's, what we're going to do with the food that we cook, well, let's give it to somebody in need. And that's how the program sort of got started 8 years ago.
It wasn't like a moment where Couch was like, we just made all this food and now we just have to leave it outside.
Exactly.
She must have had a plan, right?
Yeah, there was a plan for sure. And so, but it started with a friend asking her to teach her teenage daughter to cook. And so I think the need was there. And then we happened to just be in this incredible place where, you know, so much food grows and we have such a long growing season, which is not the same everywhere in the States. But also our program has been replicated in 8 communities throughout the country, and there's a 9th one starting now in Syracuse, New York.
I mean, that must be really affirming, you know, that you're such a model program that you can clone it successfully for different areas.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, you're working with Tim O'Reilly in the O'Reilly Media.
Yeah, so we actually have our administrative offices of Ceres now in the O'Reilly Media Center. In one of their buildings in Sebastopol.
Yeah.
And we use their land, it's 3/4 of an acre, to grow our organic vegetables. And all of that food goes into our client program.
That's amazing. And then the teenagers use that food, produce it or cook it, and then how do you distribute it to those who need it?
So the teens are, they work both in the kitchen and in the garden.
And are you, let me backtrack, are you delivering complete meals?
Yes.
Like all done?
All done.
So
we have a chicken dish, a fish dish, 2 vegetarian entrees, a soup, a salad, and a very healthy dessert. So that's what each client gets every week. And
that's
we serve
great.
Not only just the client, but the client and their families.
Right.
So right now we're on track to providing 325,000 meals since we've started the program.
Wow.
And
that's huge.
It's really huge.
Yeah.
And we serve about 100 families out of our Sebastopol kitchen right now.
And then you have the other 2 kitchens.
And then plus the other 2 kitchens. So the teens come in, they volunteer. We have mentor chefs. We have also our staff chefs, executive chef, and team coordinators. And so they all cook the meals throughout the week, Monday through Friday.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have 2 delivery dates on Wednesdays and Fridays. And we have delivery angels, which are volunteer adults that come in and get each bag that is, you know, all packed in. We use reusable containers because part of our commitment is also to a healthy planet, not just to help, you know, people with their health,
but make it
to
completely sustainable and
the planet. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And so they come in, they will get that bag that has all of the containers with all of the dishes and however many portions there are, depending on the size of the family.
They don't have to wear costumes. Or
they don't have wings.
No wings, no halos.
No.
That would totally, like, you know, that'd be awesome.
You know, that's a good idea. We should, you know, work on that.
No, I don't mean to make light of it, but it's amazing what they do. I mean,
it really is.
Who coordinates this effort? I mean, that's a lot of activity.
It is. And we have staff.
Yeah.
So, we have a volunteer coordinator, we have a delivery coordinator, so we have a number of key people at Ceres who make that all work.
What do you do specifically there?
So as the nutrition education program manager, I manage the nutrition education program.
That's good, because if you did anything else, your title would be, you know, absurd. It'd be so short, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So my main goal is to infuse nutrition information into everything we do.
Okay.
And so I work with the teens. Every day there's a break in the afternoon that we call the teen circle. It's a 30-minute break where we serve a snack to the teens, mm-hmm. and we present on a number of subjects, from food systems to games to compassion. We bring in our clients. They do client visits.
Oh, interesting.
So they come in and meet the teens and talk about their story and what it was like receiving the food.
And that gives the teens a real sense of relevance for what they're doing, too, I'm
sure. Yeah, it's really powerful. And they, you know, often they'll say, thank you so much, you saved my life. And that is huge for the teens and for all of us, really. We depend so much on volunteers for everything we do. I mean, we couldn't do it without them. And so the fact that they get this recognition right away is really beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And so the teens then have a skill set that they can take to the local job market and infuse themselves into the local economy. Have you had any success stories or breakouts with, do we have the next, you know, Wolfgang Puck coming out of here?
Well, you know, they have all found, like, Backyard, for example, is a local restaurant in Forestville, and a couple of our teens have been employed there.
That's great.
there are teens that have now gone to college and are working on food policy.
And, that's
you know, really on the big picture and food systems. There's a couple of them that have been featured in different newspapers and magazines about what they're doing. So
that's great. So food policy, that's at first that seems like sort of an abstract concept, but
right.
in terms of like influencing legislation and participating, you know, in the government process to make sure food is going mm-hmm. where it should go and how it should go.
Right.
Is that something you studied or?
Well, some of it, yes,
yeah.
but I feel like now I'm really getting into it more and more because we really want to be able to contribute to that conversation a little bit.
Yeah.
And we want to help change policy. And Catherine Couch is in a number of different alliances and associations where the conversation is going into how is food medicine and can insurance cover food as medicine,
mm-hmm.
you know, which is something
yeah.
that's happening in other parts of the country
with
really specific
yeah.
diets. And so, because it really helps, you know, people don't go back to the hospitals as often. There's more compliance with even taking pills and things like that. So having good food, you know, removing that food insecurity portion really allows for people to heal better, to, you know, like I said, not go back to the hospital
right.
as often. There's so many different pieces that get answered when there's food, real, good, honest food.
Well, let's pick this up after a break
sure.
here. We're talking with Thais Harris, the nutritional
education manager.
And education manager of the Ceres Community Project.
Same time next week?
Well, of course.
Put away a few bucks, feel like a million bucks. For free tips to help you save, go to
Feed the Pig.
In your new role, we help you help. Visit aarp.org/caregiving for information on how to provide even better care for the person who once took care of you.
And we're back with Thais Harris, the Nutrition Education Program Manager of the Ceres Community Project, and other things we'll get into in a bit. So you guys recently did some surveys with your teen volunteers who prepare all the food and learned some fairly astonishing factoids.
We did, and also with our clients.
Yeah.
So they were surveyed a few months after finishing the program, and then the teens were also surveyed after being at Ceres for a certain period of time. And what we found out is that they all have really increased their consumption of fruits and vegetables, so much so that if we project that you know, higher consumption for the next 10 years,
we'll run out.
It means 4 million more servings of fruits and vegetables just with the population we surveyed between
just
clients
locally.
And locally.
That is crazy.
So,
do you think that's a question of access or awareness or both?
Both.
Yeah.
For sure, both. But access is huge, you know, and that's part of the policy conversation is how can we ensure that people have access to good quality food, and we have a commitment to organic and sustainable food and local food as often as possible. Where we are today, you know, in Sonoma County, how can we ensure that the people who need it most, who are the people in with low income, who sometimes have more exposure to toxins and more stresses, how can they get the best food they can possibly get? Because every bite counts, right? So we want to make sure.
It's a great term, or a great way to say it, every bite counts. But you said something earlier that was interesting. It was actually a term in the last segment, food insecurity. Mm-hmm. Now, to me, that's like, I'm eating too much garbage. I'm insecure about my weight now. But what does that mean to us here in Sonoma County and the people you serve?
Yeah, it really means not having access to food. And so when you have to decide, for example, if you're under a certain medication, you have to decide whether with your money you're going to buy food or medication. You might end up buying food, right? Because you need it.
Or buying and lower quality food or the $1
exactly.
special.
Exactly. And especially there's... we need to get more information out about food stamps and other ways that there's support from the government for people who are low income, and there's certainly no shame in it. It's like there's support, the money is there, and we want people to use it.
Cause and now we have farmers markets that accept food stamps.
Exactly.
And it's amazing.
Yeah, so that's part of our commitment now, is just like, how can we help educate people not only about nutrition and the nutritional value of foods and how to eat for well-being, but also how can people get access to really good food? Because our local farms, our farmers markets, they mostly all now accept the EBT cards, and it makes it really easy for people to get access. And it's just about getting the information out there.
And in addition to all of this, you are also educating people on what to do once they've got the food, like how to prepare it. Yeah, you've got a program called Nourish Together.
Yes, yes. And it's funny, like at Ceres, I teach a number of classes. They're called Healing Foods Basics and Healing Foods Essentials, which is part of, you know, infusing that nutrition information also into the community. We work with the teens and volunteers in the community. And then outside of Ceres, I have Nourish Together, which is really focused on working with couples. And and I work with my husband in that. He is a somatic psychotherapist.
Oh, wow. So that's body-based?
With body awareness. It's still like talk therapy, but with more awareness and what things
sort of
do
the whole person,
to
not
you.
Just the mind.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
But in Nourish Together, he's not there as a therapist. It's more as a coach for opening up dialogue and really helping people communicate better, because we find that that's how people can help each other get healthier and really commit to a common goal, is if they're both really clear on what that goal is, how they can communicate with each other, how they can respect each other's needs, because their nutritional needs might be different, or maybe there's some allergies that one person has that the other doesn't. And then also how to have fun in the kitchen.
Yeah, I was going to say, how does that work in a practical sense? Like, to me, the kitchen can often be a war zone, right?
Right. So that's the idea, is like building tools, and we do some exercises so that people really can realize, like, who tends to follow more and who tends to lead more? Do you want that dynamic to change? And if not, okay, how can you work within that? And if you want that to change, then how do we change it? And then how do we... we just really work together on creating meals on each of the workshops that we do.
And so do you have couples come in, or do you go to their house, or do you have a kitchen?
They will come in. They come into our kitchen.
How many couples do you have at a time?
Right now, we've had only one couple at a time,
so
we really want to open it up to have, I think a maximum of three. I think ideal two, because it feels like between our space, and I think the idea of being in a group is more interesting than to be just a couple with us.
Yeah.
So I think two couples is ideal. That's where we're going for next.
Have you ever had any meltdowns, like in like real time kind of like issues come up? And
no, I mean, meltdowns I wouldn't call, but I think things come up, or things that people might be uncomfortable to talk about that they weren't quite sure that would come up in this situation, so.
I mean, obviously I have a very jaundiced view of couples, and any situation where, there's weapons, I'd be afraid, but it works apparently.
It works,
thank goodness. Lost any clients.
Okay. Not yet. Knives for food only.
Right, cool. And so your whole life, professionally and personally, it seems like, is invested in this concept of food. In Brazil, was this like an obsession? Not an obsession, but like was this a point of interest for you, or was it something you discovered here?
Funny you should ask.
Okay.
At home, my mom really loved cooking. My sister really loved cooking. And the two of them would often, you know, fight about, oh, I want to make this. No, I want to make this. And so I pretty much steered clear from the kitchen for the most part. Wow. And it wasn't really until I was 19 and I moved to the U.S. and I was on my own, and I had to figure it out by myself, and I had to look at food. And actually in Florida, my health changed a little bit because I kind of bought into the whole convenience food.
Right.
And I was like, wow, mashed potatoes from a bag,
yeah,
you know, and water.
Golf cart.
Right, exactly. Right. And so very quickly I realized that was not the way to do it.
Yeah.
And so that's how I started really getting into nutrition and how to eat for health.
And you arrived in Sonoma County at just the right time, where there's a real food consciousness was developing, and local foods were finally really coming up to coming into their own, and the wine and everything that goes with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, fascinating.
I believe so.
Yeah. Oh, good. Well, we've been talking with Thais Harris, the Nutrition Education Program Manager of the Ceres Community Project and a partner in Nourish Together. Where can we find you online?
You can find me at ceresproject.org.
Okay.
And also at nourishtogether.com.
There we go. That's great. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you.